In continuation with yesterday's lecture, today we will see that why it is so much important to classify organisms and what are the strategies we adopt for classification of organisms. So, without much ado, let's continue with the next part of this chapter. We know that we are in a biodiversity sea. So before we talk about biodiversity, just I wish to ask to all of you, do you know what do we mean by biodiversity? Have you ever heard about this word biodiversity?
Yes, ma'am.
What do we mean by this?
Variation of organisms.
Yes, variation of organisms.
But variety of lives.
So like I have a question here. Consider in my house, I have three members, me, my husband and myself. Can I consider it as a biodiversity?
No, ma'am.
Then aren't we various or we are varied? Someone was saying something and it was interrupted in between. So are we very variable, like we have different characters? Or we are the same? If we are variable, then why we cannot call it as a biodiversity? Can you people hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
So then please let me know the answer.
Ma'am, may I?
Yes, yes.
Ma'am, we all are the different one in the way that we have some different characteristics, but we are of the one kind as we have same body organization.
One kind. So these are the words which are constraining you from description. Is the one which I mentioned that is the need for studying this chapter. You know, the need for studying this chapter is evident over here. We should not say we are one of a kind. We should say we belong to the same species. And that is how we are. We should not say the variability in organism. We should say number of species exist in an area in a specific amount of, like in a specific duration of time. Consider, I am considering now and a few years. In this area of Ahmedabad, how many species are there? I call it biodiversity of this area. Is it clear? So we need to specifically say it is measured as number of species per area. So in an area, if it is having number of species, that can be calculated. Now, we will quickly play a game. This is area number one. Kindly have a close look at it.
What, ma'am?
This is area number one. Organisms present in this area is displayed over here. Is it clear? Now,
yes,
if I display another area, Can you kind and tell me that which area we have maximum biodiversity?
Ma'am, can you please repeat your question?
I just said this is area number one and this is area number two. Which area is having more biodiversity?
Area one.
Yes, ma'am.
Without counting, you can speak. Simply by looking into it. How many types of organisms are present over here? Can you please tell? Seventeen organisms are there. And how many are there here? I am waiting for the answer.
Ma'am, 16, 17, ma'am.
Can you count? Is it 17? So then how can you say that the area one is more having more biodiversity? You said that without counting, no? So similar count kind of mistakes are expected. Okay, similar kind of mistakes are expected, but we should not conduct such kind of mistakes. We should be clearly able to say that the one which is having maximum number of species is the biologically diverse area. So if you wish to see if you wish to see in world, 8.7 million species are there. How many? 8.7 million. So I guess you can imagine the number of species present on the earth. And out of these 8.7 million, we identified only 1.3 million species approximately. Okay, and I am talking about the data which states about this year 2018. By 2012, some of it must be identified organisms must be increased. But even if, don't you think that we hardly know our earth around us, class?
Yes, ma'am.
So yes, ma'am. We need to do extensive studies to know them. It's a very interesting chat I got, and I thought I should describe display it to all of you so that you can also take and understand knowledge from it. That yellow part is undescribed and green part is described. You can see that out of these insects, half of it is only known to us. In case of fungi, we hardly know. In case of fungi, we hardly know anything about fungi, algae, arachnids and nematodes. So many things we need to discover. So, is it easy for us to discover so many things and classify so many things and study them? What do you think?
Ma'am?
Yes, beta?
Ma'am, जैसे उस चार्ट में लिखा था कि अराउंड 8.7 मिलियन स्पीशीज है, तो मैम वो एस्टिमेट किस बेसिस पे लगाया कि इतनी स्पीशीज होगी, क्योंकि हमको तो सिर्फ 1.3 मिलियन ही मिली है.
It is like there is a formula to calculate how much biodiversity probably is present. It is a probable data. It may be a bit here and there, but approximately it is same.
Okay, ma'am.
So, like my question, again I am repeating, do you think it will be an easy job to study so many organisms?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Like, can you imagine the days when we were going to school? Sometime around, like, if your parent wish to take you somewhere, they need to collect the gate pass or early departure slip, isn't it?
Yes,
half day school mein chutti lagti hai, so some of your parents need to come. Now consider one of your parents went to school and in reception they said that I want to meet Devanshi Patel. Do you think it will be easy for that parent to meet Devanshi? Devanshi, your mom and dad can meet you easily?
No, ma'am.
So then how they need to describe?
Ma'am, they need to
one person at a time. Who wish to answer? I wish to ask Devanshi only. Devanshi? What is the correct way to do it? Can you hear me, Devanshi? We cannot.
Can please repeat your question.
So like, why, where you were? I said, chalo, Rutu will answer. You will guess the question from that. Yes, Rutu.
Ma'am, they need to mention the class and division in which the daughter studies.
Also the section.
Yes, ma'am.
That's isn't it? Huh. So they need to mention that I want to meet Devanshi Patel of senior segment, grade 11, section A of your school. So the moment they are mentioning these details, certain things are common in students like that. So there may be a specific notebook which will have names of senior segment, that is 9 to 12. There may be a specific notebook for 11, 12 grade students. In that, a few pages dedicated to grade 11 students. Amongst them, specific page for science. And then in science, we can find out Devanshi easily. And the receptionist will know, okay, this is the class teacher. This is the room number. She can send some peon to the class and can call Devanshi. So this is what is called arrangement. Arrangement of things as per their common properties makes us to study organisms easily. So that is why it's always said to be organized. Ek almari bachcho ki aisi hoti hai, like I have seen such kind of almiras, jisme jaise hi hum khole upar se kapdo ki barish hoti hai, because nothing is organized. Another is, we organized it properly. Okay, these are school uniform, these are party wear, these are like for evening walk and all these. So all things are sorted. So same way we store the files. So sorting out is very much important. So what are the advantages of classifying organisms? It will make us easily study the organisms. Why? When I am talking that human being is a mammal, the all characteristics applied to mammal will be applied to human being. Okay. We can easily remember about so many details when we are classifying organisms into a specific group. Okay. And it will give us the total picture of that organism in a very short span. Okay. And it is not only doing that, it will help us to understand the evolutionary relationship between organisms. See, evolution and classification, these two things are going hand on hand. Hum organisms ki evolutionary relationship ke basis mein we classify them. Two organisms are there. Or single organism is there, which is having similarity with, consider karo, Nidaria as well as Stenophora. Iske saath bhi, ya phir plants mein gymnosperm, ya phir angiosperm. Very much confused. It is showing similarity for both. Where to classify it? We need to see the ancestor of that organism, that it is related more in ancestry to gymnosperm or angiosperm. And according to that, we can classify. Similarly, in evolution, when we study evolution, agar hum evolution padhenge, you studied a part of it in grade 10. In grade 12, we will study it in detail. Tab aap dekhoge beta, that in evolution, basically, it is as per the classification. Jaise hum classification karte vakt ya padhte vakt, you studied classification about grade 9, isn't it? There was a chapter.
Yes, ma'am.
So, aapne padha hoga ki first in plant kingdom classification, there is halophyta, then bryophyta, pteridophyta, gymnosperm, angiosperm. Evolutionary also, jab aap evolution incident ko dekhoge, you will realize that as in during evolution also, the first organism that appeared on earth was halophyta. Then there was bryophyta. Then there was pteridophyta, then gymnosperm, and then angiosperm. So there is a close relationship between organisms, and there is a close relationship between organism evolution as well as classification. They two go, these two things go as hand in hand. Now we will move ahead and learn about a few things. First of all, we will talk about taxonomy. What is taxonomy? Taxonomy is it's a branch of biology, and it's a combination of two things, that is taxos and nomos. Nomos means naming, and taxon means it is the rank of any organism. So how we are naming organisms as per the rank, that is the content of taxonomy. So it is a branch of biology which deals with framing laws of classification. See, while we are classifying organisms, we definitely need to have specific laws for classification. Don't you think? What will happen if there is no specific law? Class?
Ma'am, the classification will become more.
Ma'am, it becomes harder to recognize any organisms.
Why?
Because of not proper arrangement.
It's not that. It's that also in this point of view, that many people can have many thought about classification, isn't it? I feel like classifying organisms like this. Others can feel like doing it like other way. Okay. So it is different for everyone. And when it is different for everyone, there will be too much confusion. So there should be a single body responsible for classification of organisms and framing laws to this. Okay. So taxonomy is a science which is well developed after thinking by the experts, and it should be applicable to everyone. It should not be like the case that only in India we are following this law. It should be same worldwide. Okay. Now, we will try to know what do we mean by taxonomic categories. categories are the rank of classification where each and every category have a name and allotted taxa. Taxa is the plural and taxon is the singular. And it is the scientific term for any unit that we are using. I know these definitions are not enough to understand. So we will look into an example. Category is an abstract. It does not have any definite thing. For example, you know about taxonomic categories like there is kingdom, then division. Now, when I'm talking about kingdom, it can be plant kingdom, it can be animal kingdom, it can be monera, it can be protista, anything. So the kingdom word is a taxonomic category. But when I'm saying that kingdom plant is a taxon. Understood beta? It's like, am I clear to all of you?
Yes,
ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So, generally, no one asks you about definition, but you should know the difference between taxonomic category versus taxon, that is taxa. So, that's why with this example, it will be quite clear to you. Now, another tug of war this chapter is having, that is the difference between taxonomy and systematics. Actually, these two are going side by side, and many a times the differential line between taxonomy and systematic is not very clear. But we need to know that taxonomy is the part of systematic. Taxonomy plus phylogeny is coming together to give rise to systematic. Now, what is the phylogeny? Phylogeny is a branch of biology that deals with evolutionary relationship. I was telling you the close relationship of classification and evolution. It was very easy for us if we try and find out the evolutionary lineage of any organism. For example, if I want to talk about whale. We know that whale. Have you ever heard about whale? Blue whale is there.
Yes, sir.
So whale, as it is having shape like a fish and it stays under water, many a times we call whale as a fish, isn't it? हम बोलते भी है whale मछली. बोलते हैं कि नहीं बोलते हैं?
Yes,
but it is different, beta. Whale is never a fish. Whale is a mammal. So how we discovered? By looking into characteristics, by looking into lineage. Fish ke jo ancestors hai, or whale ke jo ancestors hai, they are different. Not closely associated. Haan, agar aap aise sochoge, sare organisms to ek hi organism se aaya hai. Then obviously they will have a common lineage. But agar hum uski lineage, current lineage dekhe, ab current mein bhi baat hai, current lineage yaani uske maa baap ya dada dadi nahi. Like if we go back thousands of years back and then we see, because evolution is a very slow process. It requires millions of years to create a new species. That's why if we go that much back and look into the lineage, then we will be able to understand. So taxonomy plus phylogeny is systematic. So I roughly jot down the differences. It's about forming rules of classification. And systematics is not only forming rule, it's about studying that organism and giving it a proper class, that is taxonomical. Taxon we are giving it to it. That means when I'm talking about human, it is coming under animal kingdom, then it is a chordata, vertebrata, primate, and we are talking it as a human being. So this hierarchy of classification is provided by systematics. Second is systematics will include taxonomy, and taxonomy is a branch of systematics. It includes identification, characterization, classification, and nomenclature. And here only phylogeny and cladistics are added. Okay. Rules of classification change with time to time. But in systematics, it is very rare to change the specific position of any organism. There may be changes, but it is very rare. So, yes, Yashvi.
Ma'am, what are cladistics?
Cladistics. I wish to show this to you. I was expecting this question. Cladistic is a diagrammatic representation of evolutionary lineage. Okay. So, give me one moment. I can show you the cladistic images. Obviously, it's not at all part of your syllabus to go for cladistic. I guess the these are cladistical images. Okay. Which will show you the evolutionary relationship. For example, here, let me take something which will be easy for you to understand. So it says that how these organisms are related to each other. Okay. So this is the way by which organisms are classified like this. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
So we will move ahead with the chapter. If we look into the process of taxonomy, these four steps are there. Okay. First is characterization, identification, classification, and nomenclature. So we will learn about each of these steps. First of all, characterization means what? One fine morning, you are going for a morning walk and you observe the unique plant in front of you. So, if you want to be discoverer of that plant, can you tell me what is the first thing you need to do? You want to earn some, what I can say, fame. By discovering that plant species. What is the first thing you need to do? Class? No idea. Don't you think you need to study that organism? Kashish, what do you think? Should we study that organism first? Can you people like hear me? Do you think we need to study that organism first?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Otherwise, आपको कैसे पता चलने वाला है कि ये वो ऑर्गेनिज्म है जिसको आप स्टडी कर रहे हो और इट इज समथिंग न्यू. हो सकता है कि उसको थोड़ा ज्यादा सनलाइट मिल गया हो या कोई ऐसी फिनोटाइपिक चेंज उसमें आया हो जिसकी वजह से वो दूसरे प्लांट से थोड़ा अलग लग रहा है, बट इट्स वेराइटी इज ऑलरेडी डिस्कवर्ड. सो कैरेक्टराइजेशन स्टेप्स इन्वॉल्व डिटेल स्टडी ऑफ द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ ऑर्गेनिज्म एंड देन ट्राई टू लाइक कंपेयर इट विद द related characteristic organisms. So that is what is called characterization. Okay. जैसे आपको जो प्लांट मिला वो बुशी है, थोड़ा बुशी है मतलब इट्स अ श्रब. तो आपको सिमिलर टाइप ऑफ श्रब के साथ उसकी कंपेरिजन करनी पड़ेगी एंड देन यू नीड टू कंफर्म in the second step. Okay, it is a unique species, no one talked about this species earlier. That step is called identification. That means creation of its own identity. What are the characters which is not present in any of the related organism? It is unique for that organisms. Discovering that is called taxonomic identification. So characterization means studying characteristics and its comparison with related organisms. Identification means discovering the unique identity of that organism. What is the next step?
Classification.
Okay. So for classification, what we need to do, now we are confirmed that this plant is something, no one talked about this. Okay. So we need to give it a class. That means we need to give it a specific taxonomic category and taxon. Hame isko rakhna padega. Is it angiosperm or gymnosperm? Is it bryophyta, pteridophyta? What it is actually? That discovering that and designating a position into the plant kingdom is called classification. And last is the nomenclature. That means giving it a scientific name. So, which type of nomenclature is like very famous? क्लास आपने पढ़ा होगा ना, विच लाइक विच मेथड ऑफ नोमेनक्लेचर इज प्रपोज्ड बाय साइंटिस्ट एंड वी फॉलो इट.
चार्ल्स डार्विन
नोमेनक्लेचर.
IUPAC nomenclature.
Very good. In biology, what is the full form of IUPAC, beta?
Ma'am, may.
Yes.
International
Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry.
So it will be applicable for biological organisms. Do you think?
Yes, ma'am.
It will not be definitely. It's for chemical substances, beta. They are non-living. How can you apply the same law for biological organisms? What is the biological nomenclature we follow? You studied it in grade 9.
ICBN.
That is an organization. What is the name of nomenclature? Yes, Nidhi.
Ma'am, binomial.
Very nomenclature. Good. Very good. It's called binomial nomenclature. Can anyone tell me who proposed it? Carolus Linnaeus. That's why he is known as father of taxonomy. Yes, Nidhi, you wish to share something else, Peta?
No, ma'am. I was answering the previous question.
Okay. No way IUPAC nomenclature can be applicable to biological organisms. Do you think that chemical compounds and biological organisms are same? They can have same laws?
No,
what
ma'am.
Is the scientific name
no,
of
ma'am.
Human being? Someone confidently told me yes.
Homo sapiens.
So is it looking like 2-chloro, 5-promo, hexan, all? Aisa kuch. Lag raha hai iska naam? We call it Homo sapiens.
No, ma'am.
We are not giving it IUPAC nomenclature. Okay. So the next question is, why do we need to have a nomenclature? What will happen if we don't have nomenclature? Chalo, I will simplify your question. Yes, Ayushi, bolo.
Ma'am, if we don't have nomenclature, then at international level, it will be very difficult when we study any organism, as every organism has different name at local level.
Very good, Ayushi. That means if like in England, they call it guava, and I in Bengali call it peara. In Gujarati, it is called what?
Jamfar.
So, ab ek scientist ne research kiya about guava and published that article in Germany. So, German people to confused ki bhai ye kya hai? Chalo, confused hue to bhi achha hai. They can ask someone and solve the confusion. They can be confident and thought that this guava means mango, and they completed their research on and started applying the same things for mango plant. It will be a disaster. So there should be one single name which is identified by everyone. And that is scientific name of guava, that is called Syzygium guajava. So if I am using, that's why any kind of scientific communication, aap agar कोई भी साइंटिफिक स्कॉलरी आर्टिकल पढ़ेंगे उसमें कभी भी कॉमन नेम्स यूज नहीं किया जाता है. इवन इफ इट इज यूज इन टाइटल यू नीड टू मेंशन द साइंटिफिक नेम सो दैट एवरीवन शुड नो दैट इट इज अ कॉलोक्यूअल नेम इट मे बी बट इट इज द साइंटिफिक नेम सो दैट्स व्हाई वी नीड टू हैव अ प्रॉपर नोमेनक्लेचर. So, binomial nomenclature, as I told you, he is a father of taxonomy and proposed the rules for binomial nomenclature. What are the rules? First of all, if you are talking about binomial nomenclature, biological names should be always written in Latin. Hum Hindi ya Sanskrit ya Gujarati ya Bengali use nahi kar sakte. Obviously, you can modify it a bit. As like to give it a shade of a discoverer or some incident. For example, Mangifera indica, it says, because it is originated in this region. Okay. Then it will have two parts. First part is called genus, and the second word is called species or specific epithet. While writing them, there is a specific rule. Genus will always start with a capital letter and species will start with a small letter. And when biological names are printed, you need to print them in italics. If you are writing it, that means it is handwritten, then you need to underline. Trust me, I don't feel like sharing my experience. Aapko pata hai, when we were in 11-12, our teachers used to cut marks if we do not underline scientific name. Can you imagine? Itti strict checking hoti thi. In maths, I must say, if we are mentioning in Bengali, triangles are called as tribhuj. So in maths, if we are do spelling mistake of tribhuj, that is small u and badi u, then also marks was deducted. Although it was a very strict method of education at that time, nowadays things changed, but it made us perfect. So I am not going to deduct some marks from your writing, but I want all of you to practice this good habit that whenever you are writing any name, you should underline it. So systematics is like a word actually was like coined first time by Linnaeus in his book called Systema Natura. And it means maintaining systems. So that's why systematics. And these are the different taxonomic categories we were talking about. They are obviously not specific. For example, I told you kingdom can be plant and animal can be monera, protista, anything. But there is a specific way to remember these things. There is a poem to remember it very easily. That is, keep pot clean or family
got ill.
Got na gets ill name sick.
Ninth mein padha tha.
So this is the way. So it is in a way that one genus will have many species. Then family will have many genus, order will have many family, and we call this as hierarchy. Hierarchy can be compared with the steps. How? Consider these are the steps. So if I am considering height of this tail and height of this tail, this tail will have height of this as well as height of this also. Same here, it will have height of three steps. It will have height of two steps, one step, four step and five step. This type of arrangement is called hierarchical arrangement, where in one group there are subgroups and in subgroup there are sub-subgroups. That is called taxonomic hierarchy. So species is the smallest taxon and it has least number of organisms, obviously, because genus will have many species. So how can we know that two organisms belong to same species? If they can interbreed amongst themselves, that means in during their reproduction there is no problem, then we can call them they are belong to same species. I must say one thing over here, that species also can have diversities. These are called variety. In case of plant, we call variety. Like just a mango, all of them are Mangifera indica, but there are different varieties. Aap bhi jante ho kaun se variety hote hain mango ke?
Alfonso.
Bolo jo pehle bolne chahiye Gujarat ke logo ko, unhone nahi bola kaun si mango hai Gujarat ke paas. Ha,
kesar.
Kesar है ना,
हाफूस,
बादाम, हाफूस. इन बंगाल यू गेट गुड क्वालिटी लैंगड़ा, फोजली. सो दीज आर वैरायटीज. नाउ इन केस ऑफ एनिमल वी कॉल देम ब्रीड्स, डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ ब्रीड्स. एंड इन माइक्रोब्स वी यूज द वर्ड स्ट्रेन्स. बट all these organisms can reproduce among themselves very successfully. That's why all of them are belonging to the same species. Okay. Now we will talk about the next thing, that is genus. Potato, tomato, brinjal. All of them are under genus Solanum. Solanum tuberosum. Okay. Solanum oreoresia. All of them are coming under Solanum. Family is Solanaceae or Solanum, that is potato, tomato and brinjal. So family will have many genus. Order will have many family. Class will have many order. And here I wish to say that in case of animals, we use this terminology phylum. But if it is a plant, instead of phylum, we use the word division. We use the word division in case of plants. Only in case of animal, we use the word phylum. Okay. Last is kingdom. There are five kingdom classification. Now we have sixth kingdom also that we are going to study in our next chapter. So here are some example of organisms with detail of their systematics. Is this part clear to all of you, beta?
Yes.
Any question? See, in these chapters, we will not have much videos. Okay. We will have mostly contents, but we will get to know about different examples, which are very, very interesting and which will be helpful for us to identify and understand a lot about variable organisms. So I consider there is no doubts. And should I move ahead? Great. So then we will move ahead towards the, yes, beta. Anyone wish to ask me anything? So we will now
Yes, ma'am, can you please show the slide of class and order once again?
Which class and order?
Ma'am, the slides of class and order, the way we showed of phylum and like that. Can you show the class and order file once again?
Yes, I can. Wait. Actually, I closed it, so it will take some time. Yes. Wait for a moment. Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. What do you want to ask about class?
Yes, ma'am. I just wanted to see the screen. I just wanted to take a screenshot for notes.
Okay. Is the purpose served? Should I close it?
Ma'am, just show order once. Okay, ma'am, thank you.
So now we will move to the last part of this chapter, which talks about different aids that we use in taxonomy. Here, aids means helping hands that can be very useful for taxonomists, people who deal with taxonomy. So taxonomic aids are of various kinds, and we will learn about each and every taxonomic aid. And also we will learn about whatever positive and negative points they have. So first we will talk about herbarium. Have you ever heard about herbarium?
Yes, ma'am.
So what is it?
Yes, ma'am.
What is herbarium?
Ma'am, it's a place where small herbs are stored, or plant specimens or species of plants are stored.
It's a place. That means a room or a house.
No, ma'am, it's a big dome-like structure, ma'am, jahan pe matlab greenery, greenery.
Bilkul nahi. It's not that, beta. Herbariums are generally sheets in which dead plants are, dead and dried plants are like stored and for future reference. It's not a dome-like structure where live plants are stored. Okay. So herbarium is the storehouse of plant specimen. There are specific types of sheets in which plants are dried, they are pressed and preserved. I don't know if in your school you will have project related to herbarium or not, but in my school I conduct this kind of projects where students get hands-on experience about preparing herbarium. The only purpose of giving such kind of project is they will never forget what is herbarium and the process of preparation of herbarium. Basically, you need to collect an intact plant part. You need to clean it carefully so that no part is damaged. And then you need to, if you want to do it in a way which is very simply can be done in house, you need to put it into the fold of newspapers and keep it in a big book like dictionary. So due to pressure, due to absorption of water present in that plant by the newspaper, the plant will dry. And from three-dimensional structure, it will be converted more or less into two-dimensional. And then into herbarium sheet, which will have detail of everything. For example, place of collection. Maybe in some cases, they mention about the time and the date of collection also. Collector's name, who collected that herbarium, what is the local name of that plant, scientific name of that plant, family, and it can be stored. Okay, this is how herbarium sheets looks like. So why we store it? What is the purpose of storing herbariums like this? Can you tell me?
Ma'am, to remember its...
No, beta. No,
it's
one
glass kingdom.
No. It's for future because use. Others can refer. See, I want to study about a plant sitting in the Ahmedabad, which is found in hilly region. So, yes, Kanvi. Kanvi wish to say something.
Ma'am, for a future generation.
Maybe for future generation.
For their remembrance.
Very good. But for current generation also, if they refer. See, research means, aap jab koi cheez research karte ho na beta, I was part of research team, you need to first research on what to research. You need to research on something which was not like a topic of research for anyone. It should be unique. So before that, once you decide the topic, next thing is you need to study a lot regarding the background research. Isse pehle logon ne kya kiya. So every time it is not possible for us to see the live plant. Where it is not possible to see the live plant, we can refer to the herbarium sheets. And from herbarium sheets also, we can get a lot of information about the plants. So these are the dried herbarium sheets you can see. And how to make herbarium, first we need to collect the plants. Then next step is pressing and drying. And the third step is mounting, that means fixing it on herbarium paper. So for plant collection, we have book-like structures like this. This is called plant press. We can have plastic or nylon bags in which we can collect them and keep them for some time. This is a garden secateur and troll. If I'm collecting some root part, hum trowel se khod ke usko nikalte hain. Secateur is for cutting down the woody parts like stem and all. Small notebook should be there so that you can mention about the details. Jeweler's tag. Jeweler's tags are tags which can be used for tagging the specimen. Camera, if you can take photos, it is excellent. Because once the herbarium in herbarium plant is preserved, after some time it will lose color and other features. So if you can have photos, it will be great. And we need to have a GPS or altimeter to know from where I am collecting this plant. So that if we mention that in the herbarium, if others wish to study about that plant, they can go there and study. So this is how pressing and drying is performed. And then mounting, generally A3 size sheet. For students, we do it in any paper. Maybe print out the paper or project paper will do. But actually, they should be done in specific paper. Which that paper should be totally inert so that it should not be responsible for losing color of the plant. Okay, some famous herbarium collection in the world. The largest herbarium is Museum of Natural History, Paris. That is also called Louvre Museum. Okay. किसी ने वन नाइट एट द म्यूजियम देखा होगा तो आप लूवर म्यूजियम की
यस मैम
है ना इवन दिस वन व्हाट आई कैन से डाविंसी कोड देयर इज आल्सो दे शोड द पार्ट ऑफ लूवर म्यूजियम सेकंड लार्जेस्ट इज रॉयल बॉटनिकल गार्डन क्यू लंदन एंड इन इंडिया इट इज सेंट्रल नेशनल हर्बेरियम ऑफ इंडियन बॉटनिकल गार्डन That is BSI, that is Botanical Survey of India, that is in Kolkata, West Bengal. So next, that is coming as a taxonomical aid is botanical gardens. So what is the advantage of botanical gardens? Here we can study organisms in living conditions. So if I want to study reproduction of any organism or flowering, or want to do any kind of experimentation, herbarium contain dead organism. So we cannot go and see. आपके अहमदाबाद में है कोई ऐसे botanical garden, you know? अहमदाबाद और गांधीनगर और in vicinity. I know one, although I'm new to अहमदाबाद. There is one Indrona Park, no? It has lot many.
And Gandhinagar में है.
हाँ, Gandhinagar में. You once you get opportunity, you should go and visit. You will learn so many things. Okay. So it can be helpful in conservation of that plant. Promote seed conservation. So largest botanical garden in the world is Royal Botanical Garden, Kew, London. In fact, it was once upon a time largest reservoir for herbarium also. And in botanical garden in India, it is Botanical Garden Shibpur, Calcutta. This is a marvelous place. You should, if you are going to Calcutta, you should visit this place. In Gujarat, there is Sapudara, isn't it? Have you heard about it?
Yes, I heard about it.
I heard about it lot of time from my husband, but I never got chance to visit. See, this is glimpses of Royal Botanical Garden, Kew, that is London. These are leaves of Victoria Legia plants. they are so big that even a small child is sitting on them, it is not going to sink. Most important attraction of Shivpur Botanical Garden located in Kolkata is this banyan tree. It is so big and occupying a few kilometers of area, you can understand. The main stem is located somewhere, and then it like its branches is spread across a very long distance. Okay. And these are some other hindrances where you can find some aquatic plants and say Victoria Regia. Matlab dekhne jaisi jagah hai. You can go and visit. Third option is museum. Museum is the place where lot many plant and animal specimens can be stored. But like herbarium is storehouse of dead organisms, here it is same. Okay, so insects are stored in the box and everything. Ahmedabad has any museum? Class, you know? We never think of visiting such places. We think of visiting malls and all. But they are really interesting if you feel. So the largest museum in the world is Louvre Museum, once again. And in India, it is the Indian Museum, that is Kolkata. Very nice. I visited it when I was approximately 10, 11 years old. And it has one of the largest. It requires one whole day. If you want to see it also roughly, it requires one whole day to visit this. Next is Zoological Park, which is also called as Zoo. In museum, we do not have benefit of having a look into living organisms, especially animals. In zoological parks or zoo we have, we can study living animals. There, some zoo also have they are preserved in their natural environment. So these are don't have to remember it in this case. These are specific zoo which are having their own attraction. For example, Oakland Zoo is having world's largest veterinary hospital. Okay, so these are different organizations who are controlling them. For India, it is Vandalur Zoo, Chennai. It is the largest zoo in India. So last taxonomical aid that we are going to talk about is key. So what are keys? Keys are basically cards by which we can classify organisms. What are these cards and what is it? Let me give you an example. Okay. I wish to consider you have cards available with you. Okay. Like this. In a stack of cards, there are underlined cards located like this. Okay. And that means I will mark them as A and B so that it will be easy for you to understand. Consider this is the first rank. This card is A. This is B. This is the second. So I am naming this card as second of A ka Roman 1. This is second of A ka Roman 2. And this is second of B ka Roman 1. This is second of B ka Roman 2. Okay. This is the third layer where I can mention it as third A 1 third A2, third A3. Similarly, it is it can be mentioned as third B1, third B2, and third B3. सोच रहे होंगे मैम क्या कर रहे हैं क्या लिख रहे हैं कुछ पता नहीं चल रहा. Now in these cards characters are written. For example, ऊपर लिखा हुआ है plan and it is written have cell wall. And second is autotrophic. B में लिखा हुआ है animal. इसमें लिखा हुआ है do not have cell wall.
Heterotrophic.
And heterotrophic. So what you will do is you will having an organism with you, consider an organism in which there is a question mark. You don't know where it is. It should fall. आप क्या करोगे इसके अंदर characteristics देखोगे कि क्या इसमें cell wall है क्या ये autotrophic है. आपने find किया कि हाँ इसमें cell wall है और ये autotrophic है तो आपको क्या करना है ये जो card है इन cards को हटा देनी है. अब ये ए वाले कार्ड के अंदर टू कार्ड्स हैं. इसमें लिखा हुआ है कि इज इट फ्लावरिंग प्लांट और नॉन फ्लावरिंग प्लांट. आपको वापस से इसमें जाके सेकेंड कैरेक्टर स्टडी करना पड़ेगा. अब आपने देखा कि ये एक फ्लावरिंग प्लांट है तो नॉन फ्लावरिंग प्लांट के नीचे के जो भी कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स है और उसके नीचे वाला जो कार्ड है उसको आपको हटा देना है. देन अंडर फ्लावरिंग प्लांट दीज टू कार्ड्स आर देयर यू नीड टू सी इन दिस कार्ड इट इज मेंशन्ड एज नेकेड सीड एंड हियर इट इज मेंशन्ड सीड कवर्ड. वापस से आपको ये थर्ड नंबर कैरेक्टर स्टडी करनी है एंड यू फाउंड आउट इट्स इट हैज नेकेड सीड तो आपको ये वाले कार्ड और इसके नीचे के कार्ड्स हटा देना है. सो देन हर एक कार्ड के ऊपर लिखा हुआ होगा कि ये क्या है. जैसे फर्स्ट कार्ड में इट इज प्लांट सेकेंड फैनरोग्राम्स नेक्स्ट इज जिम्नोस्पर्म. तो आपको क्या करनी है वंस द प्रोसीजर इज डन देन यू नीड टू राइट डाउन कि योर ऑर्गेनिज्म बिलोंग टू प्लांट किंगडम. सॉरी एंड इट्स डिविजन इज इट इज अ फैनरोगैम्स. And secondly, third is it is a gymnosperm. You must be wondering, ma'am, इसमें क्या बात है? लिख लो ना. But when you are studying characters, actually एक दो characters नहीं रहते बेटा. More than like 10, 20, 30, 40 characters are there. And I am just giving you an example with a very small thing. So it's not that easy to do it. Okay. So that's why taxonomical keys can be very helpful for classification of organisms. Is this part clear to everyone?
Yes, yes ma'am.
Okay. So, I just will get back to the PPT and I will take 2 more minutes to finish this off. Here are some activities through which you can easily understand the concept of taxonomic key. I just want to share about that. See, this is taxonomic key, what it is, I told you. This is a dichotomous key. What do we mean by dichotomous key? That means in every branch, there are like two options. So we call it a dichotomous tree. Now, is the animation visible marked with red? Student? Yes, so this is how yes, no, it may be written and we can easily find out about the classification of an organism. So I wish all of you to continue with me for just 2 minutes and we will try and classify these organisms. Okay, let us name them as A, B, C, D. So first character is, it has wing, it has got a shell. So if I am going ahead here, it has got wings and then it has got more than 8 legs. So wing wale kaun se insects honge yahan pe? What are the insects with more than wings? A, B, C, D में से कौन सी इंसेक्ट ऐसी है?
A and F.
A and F.
So, no में आएगा A and F. अब question है, it has, नहीं, A and F में से एक भी नहीं आएगा. Think and tell me. Option क्या है? It has got wing. No. No में कौन से आएंगे? A and F तो it has got wing में आएगा ना, यहाँ दोनों पे आएंगे.
तो फिर मैम बाकी जितने बचे उतने सारे.
उतने सारे. तो हम एक काम करेंगे, पहले ये ऑप्शन लिख लेंगे. It has got wing, yes. इसमें are the antenna feather. इन दोनों में से किसके जो antennas है, they are feather. They are thick.
तो मैम B and C.
B and C. B में wing है. We are talking, see, you are not referring. First question is, it has got wing. आप उसमें yes में जा रहे हो. And then you are answering. So here in yes.
It has feathered wings.
A and F. Don't you think so?
Yes, ma'am.
अब जो नो है उसमें इट हैज गॉट मोर देन 8 legs. किसके पास होगा मोर देन 8 legs?
स्पाइडर.
स्पाइडर में 8 ही legs होते हैं. कैसे स्पाइडर होगा? यस में कौन आएगा यहाँ पे? यस में
अर्थवर्म.
No, it will be B. Generally, it has legs like this. Earthworm ke legs nahi hote beta. So, it will be E. Now, it has got shell. Kaun sa option aayega yes mein? Yahan pe?
C.
And it will be D. So, this is how by performing activities, we can easily understand the concept of.
Ma'am.
Yes, beta.
मैम आपने वो ए और एफ वाले में मैम उसमें क्या लिखा है? आर द एंटीना फेदर्ड लिखा है.
फेदर्ड लिखा हुआ है. इट इज हैविंग अ फेदर्ड एंटीना लाइक. ओके
पता चला.
सो आई मस्ट से विद दिस वी आर डन विद द फर्स्ट चैप्टर. सो यू गो थ्रू द क्वेश्चन आंसर्स प्रेजेंट एट द बैक ऑफ टेक्सटबुक एंड टुमारो वी आर गोइंग टू टेक अ स्मॉल quiz or test for this this one chapter number 10, that is cell division. Okay
ma'am.
Okay then, bye from my side. Bye to all of you.
Bye, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.